And I again welcome all of you for our today's event. I'm going to talk briefly about our group, Delhi Comparatist. The academic initiative called Delhi Comparatist started in 2010 when a group of teachers and students of the University of Delhi came together to give shape to this group. The primary thrust of this group is to develop a critical understanding of the social and political dynamics of the multicultural landscape of India. And in doing so, the literary themes such as intertextuality and transmediality serve as our cornerstones. For the past 1 year or so, we have been organizing online talks under our several research forums, and we critically try to investigate several subgenres like digital humanities, literary historiography, rhetoric studies, diaspora studies, and so on. We emphatically endeavor to create a sustainable and relevant hub that enhances and engages with the theory, approaches, and methodology of the various understanding and critical understanding. And in doing so, we are trying to engage the audience with our speakers so that there's a new dimension to how comparative studies are done today. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Shri. Today's talk is going to be slightly different from the previous ones, because in the previous talks we have explored different subfields of DH, like, you know, digital archiving and, you know, what DH looks like in India and, you know, the implications for comparatives. But today we are going to be looking into something which is a bit more of the praxis part, like in the sense that how you can use some of these text mining skills like NLP, NAR to create a project of one's own. And I think Shanmuga's work is actually a great example of this, since it connects the digital scholarship with very important issues like water, ecology, and things. Yeah, so today we have with us Shanmuga Priya. Shanmuga Priya's research and teaching interests include an interdisciplinary focus in the areas of digital humanities, digital environmental humanities, and digital literature. She is particularly interested in building and applying digital tools and technologies for humanities research. Currently, the topics, but not limited to, she focuses for her research on text mining, geographical text analysis, and digital culture. She completed her PhD at the Indian Institute of Technology, Indore. She was a postdoctoral research associate at the Lancaster University. She'll be joining as a postdoctoral scholar at the University of Toronto, and she's published in the national and international journals. And she's one of the interim executive committee members of Dharti as well. So I welcome Shanmuga again to the Delhi Comparatives platform, and over to you, Shanmuga.
Thank you, Abhishek. Am I audible? I just want to confirm.
Yes, you are.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. First of all, thank you so much for the invitation and the opportunity to share my research with you all. So I think it's better I'll start sharing the screen, then we can talk and walk through. And so I hope you can all able to see my screen.
Yes, we can see your screen.
So I kick off the presentation right away. I'm going to talk about digital application for Indian digital history. I'm so really sorry for this vague title, which I decided in the last minute, but we can discuss and we can explore more about this related topic in the press slides. So first I'll briefly talk about the digitizing process of our Indian cultural heritage. So as we, that's because digitizing itself is the foundation. It's very crucial for using digital applications or like tools or software for reading or studying the digitized materials. So first, let's talk about this digitizing process in India, then we'll move to the digital application. So As we know, there are many initiatives, important initiatives, such as National Mission for Manuscripts and Digital Records of National Library of India, and then National Digital Library of India. So these are the initiatives that showcase and catalog the digitized materials of Indian scholarship and manuscripts and materials others as well. Though these key projects, they aim to provide the access, free access and digitized materials to the scholars and students across the India. We have a few issues which deserves attention and which need to be resolved in the upcoming years, because though these documents are digitized, but still they are lacking the advanced digitizing process. For example, these documents are, most of them are just scanned images, see, just bitmaps. So we cannot use them for our machine readable format. So these are the first issues that needs to be addressed. And then comes to our digitizing local cultural heritage. So apart from these primary initiatives, which are like received attention nationally, but the geographical location and the status of the institutions or organizations across the India, which actually determine the selective digitizing process. So for example, the local libraries and archives in the small towns, villages, districts, which do not have a proper infrastructure and funding schemes. So which actually prevent the digitizing their own materials and manuscripts. So of course, India is home to many old libraries, and we have many state and district historical archives and libraries which have not been digitized yet. So many documents and materials, they become very fragile and just lying on the shelves in the small libraries and archives around the country. So this is one of the examples of the fragile historical text which I collected from the District Record Center, Coimbatore, Tamil Nadu. So I was also told that nearly 700 to 800 British cast year documents, they are like in this stage. Some of the documents which we cannot even touch them. So they are like soon to be destroyed. So in Tamil Nadu has nearly, I think, if I'm not wrong, five district record centers. So one district record center has nearly 700 to 800 British cast year documents just lying without any proper preservations. So then we can imagine other centers, and also we can compare this with other states, district record centers and archives and others, which mean most of these record centers and archives are very small ones. So which do not, which won't come under the funding scheme or won't receive the attention, proper attention, which need to be deserved. Vasundhara Jain from WinFocus private company, she actually did a survey for our project application. So she was told that many of the small libraries and archives across Madhya Pradesh, they have nearly 10,000 books which are in Hindi, Sanskrit, and other languages. They have not been digitized yet, but their condition is really very poor. So these things, like one of the challenges that prevent the digital application for our Indian historical text. So these studies actually show that still we need to go a long way to achieve our mission, machine readable text for our Indian digital history. So I'll move to the challenges in digital application for digital history. Actually, Professor Ian Grigari says that digitizing historical material itself is a two-stage process. First, we have to convert them to a bitmap, and then we have to convert the bitmap into a machine readable text. So during the process, we have few challenges. He actually points out the few challenges. First is spelling variations. During the process, the spellings gets changed according to the algorithm. So we also have few algorithm which can correct the spellings, but that end up with producing new errors. So that is a huge challenge. The another thing, we can do manual correction, but it is time consuming one. So these are the general challenges which are pointed out by the Western scholars. So then let's come to our the challenges in Indian digital history. So as we mentioned earlier, we do not have proper digital consortium or digital library that is dedicated to provide the access to the corpus of machine readable text. And this advanced digital technologies to study Indian digital historical text. However, we can still collect his messy text, which can be identified through just control and find type, that can be downloaded from National Library of India, NDL, and Google Books, Internet Archive. So these and some more venues. These are the venues that provide some of the text. Still, you can use, but you need to clean them first by using third party or the scholar themselves. So, but we do have some specific challenges. Even though we can download some of the free materials, historical materials that can be used for machine readable, but we do have some specific challenges. For example, British colonial texts are most of the British colonial texts are written in English, but they have words from other Indian languages such as Tamil, Telugu, Urdu, which are like embedded throughout the text. And then the second issue is different spellings, inconsistency in the spellings of Indian names. For example, Noyal, the river, it's a river name, but it's also a place name. So we can see different spellings for just one name in just one text. The another example I just provided in the screenshot, there you can see Bhavani is a place name, at the same time it's a river name. But you can see 9 different spellings for just one name, which is also extracted from the one text. So in order to overcome this issue, we just developed a web application, which is funded by IHRC and Lancaster University. So this application is named as Neer. This is the word, Tamil word, which means Neer. That's because this application is developed mainly for extracting water history information in the historical text. So it is developed by using customized named entity recognition, regular expressions, unique codes, MySQL, and ArcGIS map. So this unique code, which is we developed some algorithm and then we named it as a unique code. That's because it extracts words that are not in English from comparing the words from the English words database. So the user can go through the unique words and decide the words that she or needs to use as entity to extract the data that says keywords. So if you want to extract some particular information, you can use some of the keywords, and then by using those keywords, you can extract the information by using regular expressions algorithms. And you can also tag them and comment them manually as well. You can also map them automatically or manually. So this is a prototype, and still we are working on it. So I'll just demonstrate. I just as Abhi said, I also got some glitches. So I just recorded previously, so it's very helpful. I'll just play and explain. Okay, so this is the interface. Still it's in the local host. So we'll be uploading it through our project website. It's going to be open access. So this is the first interface. So where you can see, I also apologize for the lame design. So we'll try to improve the design in near future. So as soon as you open, you can see the first page that you can get started. The first page is where you can upload the file. It's going to be a login system by using proper channel. So for now, I won't show the login system and all. It's as usual like other digital web applications. So you can upload the file here, and then once it gets processed, the first stage process is it actually extracts the words that are not in English. So at the same time, when I'm saying it's English words, which means it compares the words with English words database. So at the same time, if the words that are English, but if they have some spelling errors, which means ultimately they also pop up in our list. So that's the another thing. So once you've done the process, you can see them here in the process unique words. So there you can directly click. These are just samples which we uploaded earlier. So there you can click and do further exploration. Okay, this is the next part. So once you've done the uploading the text, then you can see them here, the words that are not English. And also if you want to extract some of the keywords that you know already but from the text. So if you go through the text before uploading it, so you know that which words you want to extract. So there you can use those words as well here. So at the same time, if you do not know which words you want to you want to extract the information for particular keywords, and then you can go through these boxes, these words, and click them here, and then you can import them. Let's see. Okay, I'm just typing water, river in the entities. And then I'll be also selecting some of the words. So I'm selecting Bhavani. You can also see here many words that are Indian words, like this Kamalam Pat is the place name. And then Malathar, Dariburam is the place name. This is actually Forestry Madras Presidency, which has many scientific words for trees and other insects, and also some of the words are misspelled English words. So you can see, like, if someone have familiarity with South Indian place name, they can easily point out Tindivanam, Satyamangalam, Alangiyam, Udupi, Rikalur, Chennai, Madhapur, Chengalpet. All these are place names. So you can see for Bhavani, we have various spellings of Bhavani. It takes some time, because we don't use any plugins and all. So it's completely developed through Python and JavaScript and CSS. Okay, this is the next one. So once you've done the second stage process where you're selecting the entities or, like, let's say keywords, and then it takes you to the page where you can see all those paragraphs that related to the keywords or entities. So what it does extra, it actually identifies the place names. If we also used coding from ArcGIS. So some of the words, some of the place names that ArcGIS code, if it can identify, it actually immediately tag it as location. For example, this Bhavani, it's located, it's a location, it is tagged now. So this is automatic tag process. So you can also see them in the side panel. So whatever the entities it actually extracted. So the next stage is where you can manually tag them and then you can use comment box, other things. For example, you can also delete some of the words, tags, if you don't want them. You just decided immediately, but let's say like when you end of the process, you don't want them. So you can also delete by using this delete key button. So this the box that opens in the side panel where you can type the, you can select the words. Let's say I'm selecting this phrase. So it is a, okay. We can tag them in three categories, whether it's person, event, or place. So I'm just selecting it as an event and then typing some comment, just random comment. And then I'm tagging it as land. Okay, it's done now. So now I'm selecting a place name. So as usual, like you can provide some comment. There are like other features such as packs, which are actually specifically designed for our project. For example, we'll be extracting only two categories, place names and water bodies names. So which is why we provided only two specific tags for those things, but we are planning to add more categories, or the user can also add a particular category. So under that category, the user can extract as many entities and the information they want. Okay. So once I selected the place names, it takes you to the mapping. So it is done through ArcGIS. So there you can also type the proper place name, because sometimes you can see different spellings, like some misspelled words or place names, but you can correct them here and you can correct them in the box itself. Okay, so once it is done selecting the place name and mapping them in the map, what it does, next step, it actually identifies all the place names which we just given in the box. So it extracts all the submetrics in the entire document and tag them as location. But if you don't want the entire place name need to be identified in the document, you can simply delete them by using the delete feature. You can also see them by clicking the that I feature. And you can download each and every step, whatever you are doing in the application. So I think I didn't show that properly. Okay, here. So here you can see in each every page, you can see the this download option. So you can download from that page itself. Otherwise also you can download them in the download page. Okay. So now. Okay, download first manually analyzed by giving the input through using the entities and the unique words box. And then you can also download a CSV file of that unique words. And tagged files also you can download. And you can also download the tags separately in the CSV format. And you can also see it provides the GS code for the location, for the place names. Okay, that's all. Thank you so much. I'm looking for some questions and suggestions. Anything else, I welcome.
Thank you so much, Sanmugar. So I can see a question in the chat box. Should I read it for you? Or
yes, I'm looking at that. Two questions. Did you use OCR and Indian language corpus for this project? It's for now it is limited to only for English documents, which also has Indian names, Indian related information, whatever. So it's English alphabet primarily. And the second question is, a software planned as a trainable interface for domain? So far I do not have any skill set for developing it for Indian languages. So I'll be doing it maybe in future. Yes, we actually manipulated the SPACI coding for English, but not for Indian languages. Is it fine? Whoever it is.
It's from Rogan.
Rogan, okay, next.
Yeah, and there's another question. What about documents where place names and people names are more common?
Sorry. I think I missed one more question from Rogan. So he's asking, is your software planned as a trainable interface for domain? Da, 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 would work only for in one? Okay. No, we actually developed it for our water related works, but you can use it for any other historical related or environment related, whatever the documents. It does not necessary to be a water related. So as I mentioned during the process, we have added only two categories for now. One is place and water bodies. That's because we'll be extracting the information related to place and water bodies. But we are planning to add some more categories. At the same time, it will be allowing the user also to add some categories. So it's kind of like, you know, self-learning type of algorithm. Is this fine, Rogan? Let me know if you do not satisfied with my answer. So I'll move to the next questions. What about documents where place names and people name are more common? Oh, that's a good question. So I think that's our duty to tag them. Like you can use the comment box. Like if it is, as I mentioned, Noyal Bhavani, both can be addressed to place name at the same time, both are reverse names as well. So you can use the comment box because you don't use like the downloaded extracted paragraphs directly for your research. Then you will be doing again your analysis. So during your analysis, you want to know, right? Which one you extracted for which purpose. So which means ultimately you have to use the comments and again the tags box where you can tag them. This is I selected for this purpose. Like, you know, that's the researcher's duty, I guess. And also you can distinguish them by using the three tags category in the beginning, like whether it's person, event, or like place names. There you can use it, like if it is person name, Noel, you can just you know, click that person name. If it is a river, in one document, you can see both river name and person name, Nuyal, Nuyal. So you can use the place category for Nuyal, and you can use for person category for Nuyal. Second question.
There's another, Ruhan is written, can you also answer the OCR part in the first question?
OCR part. I thought I answered for the first part of the question in the first question. So far, I didn't explore for Indian languages, whatever OCR or any coding things and all. So OCR, it is actually problematic because we also faced many issues. But we actually clean the text. First, we have to clean the text before uploading it in the application. So we cleaned by using third party because we have a lot of text to be processed. So it is actually listed in the funding already. So we cleaned them already. But if you are using only one or two texts, you have to clean them first by using many online applications are available to clean them. Or if you know how to clean them manually, if you know the Python, if you know Python or some other languages, so you can also do the cleaning process before uploading it in order to avoid the OCR issue.
Thank you. Amitabh has raised his hand. So Amitabh, would you like to ask her or any comments? You are on mute, actually.
To Shanugam. Yes. Shanuga. Yeah, I know. You understand that you have explained it earlier. What Rohan was asking, I'll add to that.
Sure.
You have offered us a very interesting understanding about what you have been doing. Right?
Yeah.
And what Rohan is asking, he's not just asking. He also have been doing that.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, but I think Rohan is not trying to collaborate right now. So he's
okay,
just
asking. I'm fine.
I would ask Rohan to join the discussion. It's not about asking questions, Rohan. It's about sharing your experience with what Priya has experienced.
Exactly. That's what I'm looking for. I need more kind of, it should be discussion type. And
yeah.
Comments besides.
Rohan is, I'll not say more, but Rohan, please join the discussion. By the way, Priya, I have,
yes.
My point was that until Rohan asked those questions, I found that your experiment was very limited.
Yeah. Mm.
And I also have a student here. You are not my student, but Rohan here, whose experimentation is much larger.
Okay.
We can learn from your experience. And also, we can come together when we talk. I loved your presentation.
Thank you.
But coming from a very specific space and time. And that's us from the subcontinent. We are all limited by space and time. Me at this age, and you will be at this age. So Rohan, I have a request to you. Why don't you just stop asking questions and join the discussion? Because Priya, I'll tell you one thing. What you have told us is very important. But there have been other ways, avenues to go beyond. I remember when you said that we have to clear the pages, etc. And Rohan asked about the OCR.
Okay.
Yeah. And in Delhi, not essentially because we are in Delhi, we could do it in Calcutta or Madras. Pardon me. For a Bengali, Madras is still a Madras.
Okay.
And I love to say that. Okay. I think what we need today, after what Priya has said, is a conversation between Rohan and Priya and others. I don't know all of any of this. But if Rohan is listening, I am asking you, Rohan, please make it a conversation, not a question-answer session. Okay, if Rohan doesn't join, he's very shy. So, Priya, I'll ask you one thing.
Yeah.
You are trying to develop something.
Yes.
How much have you talked to other centers of India who are trying to do the same? If you have not, then don't you think we need a platform where we can talk? Okay, that's a very easy. Oh, now Rohan is joining you. I'm done. Thank you. Rohan is joining. Rohan, please talk.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Yes, you are.
Yeah. So the reason I ask about this word error rate efficiency question was because I have been trying to OCR some of a little corpus that I'm going to study for my PhD in Bengali and Urdu. So I've been experimenting with SPACI, and first of all, SPACI doesn't yet support a lot of Indian languages. There has been some development work that is going on for Urdu that I know, and some development is also happening for Hindi. So these are the three languages that I work in. And one of the biggest issues that I have faced till now, my OCR models, they are at an efficiency rate of somewhere around 98 to 99% character error rate. So it comes around to a word error rate of 90%. So the first time I experimented with SPACI for English language texts, with the text that I had OCR'd and didn't clean, it became quite problematic for me to extract those entities, because some of the errors that I was trying to some of the entities, some of the interesting entities that I wanted to extract, especially related to names and geographical locations, they had a lot of errors in there. So that is why I asked this question of how much word error rate is okay for NER extractions using more domain agnostic software like SPACI. Because one of the limitations with NER that I found is that it takes away a lot of it provides a new kind of interface which is great for someone who doesn't code, but for people who are learning to code like myself, it might be limiting, because it has a very domain specific application, right? So that is why I've been experimenting with SPACI, so that I can extend the limitations of the projects that kind of you have presented here. So perhaps in that context, I asked about OCR efficiency for NER extractions. So if you have any insight on that, it would be great for my project. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. And we really okay sounds very interesting. As I mentioned earlier, I don't work with Indian languages, so I do not know how that is error rate and all. So for this project, like as you mentioned, as Professor Amitav mentioned, it's limited. It's limited in the sense it can focus only on the English text, which also has Indian related information. That's the focus. That's all. That's the focus. So when it comes to OCR, so we didn't work on the OCR. So we actually have some of the text which already done some of the, that work is done by third party, by using third party for this project. So we didn't work on the OCR part, which is why I was not able to answer your question in the beginning itself. I didn't OCR part is done by through third party, because we have hundreds of books. This is not a PhD research. It is a research funded by AHRC. So we need to collect more than hundreds of books by using Internet Archive, Google Books, other related venues. So I didn't get chance to explore OCR part. Extracting errors from SPACY for even English entities, right? So I don't remember the SPACY errors for extracting information by using SPACY. What we did, we actually manipulated algorithms from SPACY, ArcGIS, and regular expressions. So we combined all three of them, not just SPACY. So first, what we did, we used SPACY for selecting the entities. And then we used regular expressions to extract the information. So the SPACY part, it's done with entities itself. And the next part is done by regular expressions. And then third part, mapping and mapping and coding, mapping like selecting place names and tagging automatically as a location is done through, again, ArcGIS and plus JavaScript. So these are like combined version of different languages. Is it okay? Okay, great.
Yes. Thank you for that.
Yeah. So we can also discuss, if you mail me, like we can chat and discuss. Not necessarily to be collaborated. We can work, we can discuss some of the parts. So I can see Professor Amita raised his hand.
Amita, would you like to add something to this, or like any further comments on the discussion that is going on? Or any other participant who would like to ask their questions directly to Sanmuga, or you can even type your questions in the chat box and we can take them up.
I welcome any type of session. So yeah, please. Yes.
I wonder what would be I wonder about the availability of the interface that you presented. Is it going to be available through, as a web application that we can install through Docker or something else? Or,
no. It's going to be a web application. So you can use them directly through our project website by using login system.
Nice. Thank you.
Okay.
Any further we have a question from Abhishek.
Yeah.
So he's asking, would you be interested in working with Indian languages in future?
Yes, I'm interested. So in University of Toronto, there is a research group that's working in Indian languages, particularly Tamil, for creating software and web applications and other digital studies related to Tamil language. So I'll be joining them, then I'll be learning and working with them.
Any further questions or any feedback? Yeah, sure, Amita, please go ahead.
Thank you for this deliberation and sharing your experience with us, but right now I'm suffering from the second vaccination trauma.
Oh, I'm so sorry to hear this.
No, that's fine. What I am more interested in is if you and Rohan in this lecture can have a discussion. You have been working concentratedly on assorted aspects. Rohan also has been working, not so concentratedly in the sense that he's our students from Delhi University, and you know, capital doesn't have a character. And so I would really love if you and Rohan in this course of discussion, today's discussion, converse and let us know how we can get the leap, make the leap, like inductive. I'm not meaning inductive leap. I don't know. I mean, I don't know how many of you have studied logic. So inductivity is a big thing. And that's why I'm very interested when I'll be very interested if you and Rohan talk here and chalk out a plan.
Yeah, I think one of the biggest limitations for this kind of work in languages is obviously what Shanmuga pointed out at the beginning of the presentation.
No, but Rohan, did you think that what Priya was offering, from our perspective, it sounded too limited?
I mean, I don't think it's limiting. I think the interface, the application is designed for a particular project, and the code I believe that because it is based on SPACY, so by licensing rules, it has to be open source, and anyone who has knowledge of who has expertise in that domain can extend that code and include other kinds of functionalities that he or she wants to include. Mm-hmm. So I don't as per think that the project is limiting for the kind of work that we do at the Department of Modern Indian Languages and Literary Studies and Delhi Comparatives. Mm-hmm. But what I think is lacking for harnessing these kinds of digital affordances in analyzing and studying in asking literary questions in our domain is perhaps the very very limitation of machine executable data. So the government funding in creating these mass digitized archives, which are based on these advanced techniques that Shanmuga pointed out in the beginning, they are lacking. They don't really exist. So it becomes the responsibility of individual people, or what I want to call citizen scholars. A lot of work has been happening in this domain in Sanskrit. A lot of people who are computer scientists or work in big tech companies, they have been kind of developing these kind of tools and applications for bringing out domain knowledge in Sanskrit. So OCR is one of the biggest limitations for this. And once we have a corpus, once we have a big enough corpus and enough people working on solving this problem, only then the kind of leap that we think should happen might be possible. Because we cannot search a scanned image, right? We need to search the words and the sentences and the phrases. So for that to happen, the corpus has to be, in my opinion, that is one of the biggest limitation. I don't know how to.
Rohan, is it about the corpus or is it about us coming together?
I don't really see. I mean, yeah, there is a lot of technological challenge as well. So with Bengali, what I've found is I've done a.
No, Rohan, I'm not talking about Bengali. Rohan, let me complete.
No, I'm using Bengali as an example.
Sorry. No, what I found is Priya has been working on a certain space.
Right.
And she has been doing wonderful. She has presented it. The point is, given our perspective and our background, if we want to include in our quest, then what should we be our position?
Number one thing is to, and I would ask Shanmuga to kind of also come in on this. I think we need to improve OCR efficiency. That would be that is the number one issue that is limiting us at the moment. OCR efficiency for English languages, for Indian languages. English, it's already there. I don't know what Shanmuga thinks about this, but I would love to hear her opinion as well. So what do you think, Shanmuga, about this issue?
Okay. It's available for English, but not for historical texts that are written in English, because especially if you take Western historical text, so they have done a proper, like, you know, OCR method and handwritten OCR type method, everything they prepared. But still, they also encounter some of the issues of spelling variations.
Right.
As I told in the presentations, they can also use spelling algorithms, but it's very challenging. But ours is more than, like, just not one challenges. We have many challenges. First of all, we do not have any proper corpus that is clean and coded that can be readily used to in some applications. So first of all, we have to work on that OCR thing and every other cleaning process and all. The second, once you've done the cleaning process, the second challenge is, for example, yes, my first research is limited to British colonial text. Okay, so in that case, that's why I can give example from that. So from that perspective, though it is clean and written in English, again, we have specific challenges because different spellings, not even one spelling variation, not even just common English word, it's Indian names that are having English alphabetical. That's the huge challenge. So based on that, I created this web applications. So it can be useful to students or scholars, whoever is going to work on historical text or any other text which are written in English but has Indian names. So that's the challenging we face. So say third thing, for Indian languages, we also have some of the words in the historical text, Tamil word. If you read East India Company text, you can see English throughout the page, you can see English, but immediately you can see some paragraphs in Urdu, Tamil, Telugu. So we don't know how to, like, extract from them. I don't have any computer science background. I'm still trying to learn and everything, explore. And I also seek help from computer science. So with the help of computer scientists only, we developed this application. So I need to acknowledge that. So that's the issue. So we do not have, first of all, a cleaner text. Second, if it is cleaned as well, we do not have advanced digital technologies that can extract both English and Indian languages.
Right. Go on,
please.
So yeah, historical orthography is like one of the major issues that I also faced while developing the. So I recently finished OCRing a corpus from 1900 to 1920. It has around 30 poetry and poetry books published during this period. So there, I and now poetry is written also in a very non-standardized dialect, right? It's not the standardized kind of dialect that you'll find in journals. It has examples of regional variations. And there the spelling might vary a lot. And even if you're coding for a particular spelling based on some sort of dictionary that you have defined, I think one of the biggest difficulties that comes in working with these historical, with historical documents in Indian languages, and I'm talking primarily with my work on the basis of the work that I've done in Bengali, I think it's the variation of the regional dialects that kind of seep into these texts. And when we start to model the language used in these languages, the problem of historical orthography kind of aggravates further. So yeah, you're right in pointing out that spelling variation is a significant challenge. Mm. And the second issue that you pointed out about multi-language text. So I recently worked with samples of literary histories in Urdu, Hindi, and Bengali. And in these literary histories, you'll find I was able to find texts which were written a lot of text in English. A huge percentage of the text was in English, and then a huge percent of the text was in Hindi, especially, or the language that they were historicizing, right? So for Hindi, you'll see examples of pad, of poetry, of in the same in Bengali and the same in Urdu. So one of the challenges that we face that I faced in kind of working with this is that the OCR model that I am training, should I make it for English? Should I apply the English model, English language model for OCRing that text, or should I apply the Bengali language text? And I recently stumbled on like this recent innovation that is happening in Germany. So what they're developing is that they are trying to identify the script based on the shapes, the glyphs of the characters, and the interface is designed in such a way that when you have like a couple of models, so for instance, I have a text that has four languages, Urdu, Bengali, and English. So what I can do is I can feed my text into this application that they're building, and that application would identify the script. So first it will identify the script that are in use and where it is used on which lines, and appropriately it will call the appropriate model for that script and apply it on that line to OCR that. So these kind of innovations, I think these kind of challenges, I think, are something that are happening. The kind of work that needs to be done in digital humanities, that can have to be done in digital humanities in India. And hopefully with time and with collaboration, we might be able to arrive at a point where this is common sense, right?
Yeah.
So thank you very much for your interesting presentation.
Thank you, Rogan.
Yeah, Amitabh, you want to add something to this?
Yeah, of course.
Thank you.
Priya Rohan is my student.
Okay, great. Nice.
And to you are also of the age, actually my student's age. You know, I mean, I was not for anything asking both of you to talk. We belong to a generation where the issues that you are dealing with, we had not been. And we have not been trained. I'm sure in your masters, you also are not trained into those. But the point is, this is the future. And there I wanted you to talk to Rohan, not just because that Rohan is one of my, I hope Rohan is not here. Rohan is one of my questions. I won't use superlatives. But at the same time, what you talked about was very important for me. You know, there are ways that an old teacher judges a student, saying that you are limited, or saying that you have gone beyond. What I have felt through your presentation is that you are doing something. And why did I add Rohan into the discussion? Because he's also trying to do something. It's not about that man. It's about man or woman. It's about the person. You know, I told Avishek before the meeting began that I'm already suffering from fever. I won't join, etc. But you know, I want to tell you one thing. The qualitative understanding of literature will continue. But the way you are understanding it, the way Rohan is understanding it, is the future. Not the only future, of course, will be there. Doing philosophies, now and then. Because literature is nothing beyond philosophy. But okay, beyond that, these are important. I just want to tell you one thing. With your expertise and concentration on a particular space, and with our comparative literary expertise, which is a non-expertise of dealing with everything, let's come together. And only that will make Delhi comparatives meaningful. At one end of Delhi comparatives will be there like people like me who will be philosophizing. And on the other hand, there would be people like you and Rohan will be working on data. And I wish there would be a day when both of us will meet on a point. Thank you, Pratya.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, sorry.
It's okay.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Mito. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, now I'm leaving it. But yeah. I really want you to be a part of what we are experiencing and experimenting.
Sure. That's honor. Thank you.
Because I'll stop here. Because your experience is very located. And this, from certain perspective, it might sound like very restricted, but it's not. Because the located perspective is the best one that comes from a location. And the moment it can converse, dialogue with a larger perspective, that's when knowledge happens. Okay, I'm leaving. Thanks a lot.
Okay, no problem. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, any further questions or comments? Participants can directly ask or type in the chat box. Abhishek, do you want to add something to this?
Thank you so much for the discussion, sir. And it really, gave us a lot of insights. And I really feel that your work is very inspiring. Even which is about the quantitative analysis of English fiction, and the work that you're doing right now also, which is in intersection ability and digital humanity. So I was very happy that, you did this project, and, I just wanted to, want everybody here to see this kind of project where, you're using this kind of historical reports to look at, using digital tools to extract this kind of words and everything. So thank you so much for this, and thank you so much for presenting your work, and thank you for the discussion as well.
It's wonderful. Thank you so much for the invitation.
So if there are no further comments, yes, Abhishek?
Yeah, you can end the session. End the session.
So may I ask Amitava to say the thank you note?
Yeah. Priya, as I told you that I'm supposed to give the thanks note. I was. But okay, the way you presented and also the way I sort of pushed the conversation between you and Rohan was not for without any reason. First of all, thanking you for sharing your experience with us. But after what I have said by now, I think what I want to say is that please join us. And given the generation I'm coming from, I don't understand all those things, algorithms, etc. And I said algorithms, not algorithms, because I wanted to say that. But this is the future. You also know that. thank you for your lecture, and I could be very polite and say that you have been wonderful, etc., which you were. But I have a request to you. I'll not end with just saying you have been wonderful, etc.
Yeah, I'm not perfect. I know.
No, it's not about being perfect. I'm not perfect either. No one is a perfect person.
Yeah, then I agree.
What I was trying to tell to you, Priya, is that join us. Maybe together with all the limitations we have because we are coming from a third world country. Maybe this situation has given us the space. Let's use that and let's claim the world. When I was a student, I used to dream that, and my teacher told me, oh, don't, please. He was a sensible man. But today, I think we can do that. The only limitation that I have found, pardon me, in your presentation is that you are concentrating on a very specific data. And the only limitation that Rohan has is he is concentrating on a very expanded. When both of these come together, then we'll rule the world. Okay, we'll never rule the world anyway. Thank you, Priya.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I hope that you will be a part of DC after that.
Sure. It's really hard not to be part of
anything, but because we are trying.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Okay. Thank you.